my son, I had it up on the mirror in our ensuite, my son, and he goes, "You're not adventurous, Mum." I was heartbroken, absolutely heartbroken that he thought that, because I was like, "I'm the most adventurous person you know." But he hadn't seen that side, and yeah, I just thought he has to see that in me. My daughters definitely know that side of me.
Hello and welcome to the New Directions podcast, where we specialize in helping real women achieve real transformations.
Okay, welcome, girls. I am very excited to be introducing today our good friend Jo, who is, oh, I feel like you are the basically the essence of corporate mums, which, and I mean that in the biggest compliment ever, which is you've toned up 10 kilograms, which is awesome. So as far as fitness goes, you're crushing that. You have three kids, and so, you know, there's responsibility. You're also, you know, doing very, very well in your career. And from the outside looking in, you're nailing it, right? And I'm sure it's like that on the inside as well, but obviously you're aware of all of the decisions and balancing you have to make. So without further ado, welcome, Jo.
Thank you, Matt. Oh, that's my phone ring.
Yes, corporate world. This is.
I know that you think I'm nailing it on the outside, but sometimes on the inside I don't feel the same, but we'll get into that, I'm sure. Bit about me and my background. I was a very sporty kid. We were a family that did a lot of sport. I was competing from the age of 7 in swimming. We did a lot of bike riding, snow skiing. My parents were into cross country skiing as well. My dad was a very good squash player. He tried to teach me that, but I didn't have the handball coordination. Mum was a netballer and was involved in netball for a long time, as well as umpiring when she finished playing. But I played basketball, being tall, and so did my brother. And yeah, we just, every night of the week, there was some sport on, and we were very involved in it at school. And when I moved to Melbourne in my 20s and met my first husband, he was also very sporty, and we got into triathlons. I was swimming for masters. We would ski and cycle and do a lot of Audax rides and a lot of hiking. So we've been to Nepal and hiked, and I loved that lifestyle and loved being very sporty. When my first kids came along, when my eldest, who's now 19, came along, obviously I still tried to keep up as much sport. And all through this, I was also developing my career in marketing through my 20s. And when I had my first children in my 30s, I went back to work very quickly, and it did become harder to stay as fit. And even though I was with my first husband until my daughters were 2 and 4, but it was a priority with us. So we would try and do things where we had the seats on the back of the bikes. We had when we went skiing, we would have like a little caboose thing that we used to use when we cross country skied. So we did stay as fit as possible. But his fitness became more of a priority than mine. And obviously, a lot of the time, that's the same with caregiving. It's mum is the one that stays home and does more of that. And also, because I was back working full time, it really did become a juggle. And I did notice I started to put on a few kilos and not do as much. A few years down the track, met another man after I'd been separated for a while. And even though that he was also into cycling, and we met cycling when we were cycling, it wasn't an obsession. So, you know, and we did lots of other things, and we traveled a lot, and we were involved obviously with the kids, and then I had another child with him, and then work really became very demanding. And I got to a point where I just all of a sudden put on all this weight. And after I'd had my third child at 41, it was much harder after having him to lose the weight. And all of a sudden I was 20 kilos heavier than I ever had been. I'm like, what has happened? And I think for me, it was looking at myself and my lifestyle and thinking, this isn't me. This isn't who I am. And I had started a fairly new job. I'd been in a new role with a new company for about a year. And I thought, these people don't even know who I am. They only see this frumpy mum. that comes to work and works ridiculous hours, and you know, I'm presenting to them, and you know, got a really, you know, mentoring the younger guys at work and things like that, but they didn't see me as a person that had pushed myself, you know, in trekking in the Himalayas, or you know, involved, you know, riding a 200-kilometer Audax ride, or competing in triathlons or swimming races. And even though I suppose it didn't matter for me, it did, because that was who I was.
So is that when you started to see that there was a little bit of a disconnect between the way you were portraying yourself and who you believed yourself to be?
Yeah, I think that I was, I'm trying to think how I would explain it. I just felt like I wasn't in my own body. I suppose that's, so in my head I was me, but I would look at my body and think, that's not my body. And I really missed being that active person and people seeing me as that active person. Yeah, so I think that was hard. And it came, and obviously I'd been coming to see you, Matt, and then I had stopped thinking I can't juggle it all, and I'd started a new job and thought I'll go to training with one of my daughters and go to the gym. But I just wasn't, I was too tired, not motivated to do it myself. There was a day at work which was a really hard day. I had a terrible argument with my boss, and usually I would have, you know, told him what I thought, but it really upset me, and I just went home and I was a mess. And I thought, this isn't me. This isn't a strong, independent corporate woman who, you know, can be the only female in a room, but doesn't, you know, that doesn't bother me. And I felt, yeah, like I was falling apart. And I thought, I need to get myself back on track. And I, one of the things I did is I stopped drinking alcohol during the week. I stopped having a wine while I was cooking, or wine with dinner. Mm. And yeah, rang Matt. I think I texted him. I said, oh, I need to come back.
It's always good to know the backstory of the message.
So
what do you think, what were some of the major changes? Because obviously, so what I'm hearing as well is that you're being stretched in a lot of directions, and you had, in one way or another, made a deal with yourself that you would make your career and your family ahead of your own personal needs for a period of time. And definitely correct me if I'm wrong. And eventually, though, you started to realize that you were not as strong as you once were. Maybe mentally, emotionally, physically, it could have been any of those things. And until it kind of got to breaking point, and then you went, okay, I now see that this current rhythm of my life is not sustainable, or if I do sustain it, it's not going to be kind of a great result over the next 10, 15, 20 years.
Yeah.
So where did you, so we started with the text message, and then had you already given up alcohol prior to that message? Because I know we talked about it a bit, but when did the, so it was the first step going, whoa, this is a bit of a breaking point, I need to do something.
Yeah, I'm trying to think back.
Mm.
You mentioned about, you know, the making a decision to put corporate and family first. Sometimes I don't know if it's a conscious decision. I've always been very driven in my career. And so, and I really love the work I do. So I think it just ends up taking over, and then for whatever reason, I don't put myself first. Yeah, I don't know if it was conscious though. It just happens, because it's always been something I've just done.
Yeah.
So now I'm trying to think more consciously about, no, I need to have time for me. And even this week, I knew it was going to be a really, really busy week at work, and had a late night Tuesday. We had international visitors for work, and we had them out for dinner, and I just said, I can't get up to train, even though it would have been good. And I also made the decision to work from home so that I wouldn't even have to get dressed up.
So you could get extra sleep.
Sleep and not put on makeup.
Yeah.
Sorry, but your other question. I'm sorry, I've gone off track there.
No, not really. Like, I mean, it makes total sense. And I, yeah, even when I said those things, I certainly don't think of it as conscious. I think of it as more where you put your time and energy.
Mm.
And it makes total sense in that it's like, okay, well, you know, I love, you know, between the ages of 20 and 30, if you're chasing, or not even chasing, going after aggressively career, then it only makes, it's kind of like, perhaps there's an idea that it's like, okay, then once I have kids, it'll just be, you know, plus a kid.
Yeah, that is exactly how you think. Yep, yep.
Whereas, perhaps there's also like a very big emotional shift and focus that kind of goes, okay, well, now I've got to divert my focus, obviously, in multiple directions.
Yeah. You asked about the alcohol, and I think for me, I'm a very much, if I decide to do something, I then, it's like all happens at once.
Mm-hmm.
So I think I made the decision to text you, cut out the alcohol, change my diet, sort of all in once, because I do know what to eat, what's right and wrong, but portion size and for me was an issue, and then I would snack. And I knew that wasn't good. So I cut out that and so forth. But I think many women probably feel the same as me, is that you just have to be able to do everything. So I definitely do more around the house. I do have a cleaner, but I do more. And I do the cooking. I'm working full time and easily a 50-hour week.
Mm-hmm.
And then taking kids to the bus stop and then making sure that I'm, you know, just being there for them and their things that they want me to be involved in as well. But I think at some point you've got to actually say, I can't be super mum or super woman. And that's where I've got to. I'm not going to be super woman.
Absolutely. And so you've got the, because one of the ways that I look at it, sometimes I talk about this whole biopsychosocial dynamics where so I can think back and I remember we had conversations where biologically basically your stress levels were going up and up and up.
Mm.
Your immune system was decreasing in its quality, which is just expected. Yes. When you're in a stressful environment. And then from the psychology point of view, you'll find that you're not as strong. Like, as in, what I mean by that is you won't be able to, you know, do your 20-hour gung-ho shift. And when I say shift, it might be at work, or it might be, you know, smash out a 12, 13-hour day at work, come straight home. The feed, bath, and then obviously bed. And even when they're teenagers, you still need to get them to go through those stages. But
And homework.
Mm. And then obviously perhaps you've got something else to do that you forgot to do at work, and so you're smashing that out late at night.
Mm.
Or you're going over, especially if you've got a big presentation, you might just be going over that just to calm yourself.
Yeah.
And then you've got to hit the deck real quick because you know you're getting up early, and then you're going to be smashing out some more coffee for some people. Mm. For other people, so all of those things then mean that you're going to likely like move into a little bit of a vice. And also then on the social side, if you know you're hanging out with a lot of people where drinking wine every day is the thing to do, it's incredibly common, you know. Women in this age group of, I think it's 40 to 55, they're actually the highest. They drink more than men now, on average through the week. So,
yes, I read that.
Yeah, and that makes sense in that if you consider the reason why they're doing that and why it's natural to lean that way is because you're just trying to calm. Mm. Like, you got a lot on your shoulders. Do you have any thoughts on me thinking in that way?
Oh, no, it's true. And I think you get home and you've already been in traffic for half an hour or however long it is taking home from work. You then pretty much walk in the house dealing with biting teenagers because someone stole someone's clothes. You're cooking dinner, you're ringing your husband, he's picking up one of the other kids, they're going off to sport. And so it doesn't stop until about 9, 9:30. And I think that's the same for most families with teenagers. And you know, my range of kids is from 8 till 19, so it's quite a broad range with the three, and so you're picking up for some of them need to be picked up, some don't because they've got their license, but there's also that they're learning to drive, they want time with you to do that, so there's a lot of things. So you do put yourself last most days, and then when you do have some quiet time, a glass of wine is very nice with some cheese or chocolate.
I see. So, okay, so now we've talked about the problem,
yep.
And we haven't even touched on the whole sandwich generation factor, but, so we've touched on the problem, how, because you have turned things around in some categories,
yeah.
And when I say turn them around, I just mean as in, you're obviously managing large scale of responsibilities and roles well. And I imagine as well, it's also to a degree the ability to say no to certain people and therefore say yes to you. So what things have you changed, do you believe, in order to make this happen? So there's the backing off on alcohol.
Yeah, backing off on alcohol. Definitely changed my diet, and I'm actually saving a lot of money because I'm taking my lunch to work every day. I would go downstairs to the cafe that was downstairs, and you'd have a, you know, bigger lunch than you would normally, especially with sandwiches. It's more like focaccias and that, they're quite big, or wraps. So now I take a salad with either some leftover chicken from the night before, or fish or something like that.
Yeah.
And just definitely thinking more about portion size, not having the snacks as much. I do let myself have Friday as my cheat day. There'll be something, call it Fuck It Friday. I had a nice roast pork roll with coleslaw. That was really nice. But then I had fish for dinner. So I am trying to be good in that way. Definitely now making time for the exercise, walking more, and I've set some goals around that for this year. I've had to change things a little bit because of one of the kids getting up earlier now for school and catching a different bus. So making the effort to get to training at the 5:30, is that right? Mm-hmm. 5:30 class. Mm-hmm. That I never thought I would be training at 5:30 in the morning.
You're an inspiration.
But I love right it. There. I do. I love getting up and training in the morning now. And my family laughs because I'm when I get home, I'm on and I'm doing a million things and talking a million miles an hour. And they go, "Have you been training, Mum?" But I fit in now. I can fit in that and a walk with the dog before I have to take Soph to the bus stop. So that probably the hardest thing for me, probably more, is on the socializing. I love to socialize and spend time with friends, and I do love to have a glass of wine and entertain and do a nice platter and things like that. So for the last 6 months while I've been training again, I did consciously cut back on that so that I wasn't doing as much social drinking or social eating. I do still find that very challenging when I'm with friends. If I'm going to their house or they're coming to my place, I try to have better options. But yeah, I know that that's where, you know, we've got a night where we're sitting around talking and drinking and eating, and it is a bit harder.
Yeah, and that's a really hard one because obviously I want you to be socializing as much as possible, and I think it's a wonderful thing, but at the same time it would be nice to it would be hard because I understand that it would be going against like the social norm, but to kind of show your values through, you know, and obviously you're doing that by saying, oh, this is what we've got for food today, but also like on portions. I think that sometimes we're kind of in a society at the moment that loves displaying abundance.
Yeah,
for sure. Mm. But yeah, and so therefore, like if food is good, more is better. And that just being the rule of thumb, more is better. So, yeah, whereas perhaps the middle is better, the mean, you know, yeah. Between the two extremes. So, anyway, obviously, that's my opinion.
No, it's a very valid opinion, Matt.
But then, so talking through a little bit more, and only as much as you're comfortable with, because we have had chats where now that you once you kind of draw your attention to the decisions you're making around food and alcohol, it also then makes you notice the decisions you make when you're with certain people. So like, for example, some people, you know that if you hang out with them, you will typically only hang out with them when you're out for drinks or something like that. So how have you found that to be the case? And if so, how have you managed that type of relationship? Like, have you tried to steer it in a different direction, or does it not come up?
Yeah, I know the people that I mix with that do like a drink. And interestingly, a few weeks ago, we caught up and I wasn't drinking as much. I was drinking a lot of mineral water. And it was, you know, I could hear them starting to slur, which I probably wouldn't have picked up before. But I was happy not to wake up with a hangover.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah.
Connected it with happiness at the end.
Yeah, being able to still get up. Yeah, I don't know. I haven't steered away from those people. They're very important people in my life. I just have to... And there's no pressure either. There's no pressure from them to be keeping up with them. Not at all. I think it's just you get into a space where you're just going along and everyone's drinking and more wine is getting opened and you're just enjoying the night. And that has been, you know, I saw that in my parents, and I, you know, all my adult life, alcohol and food has been an important part of a, you know, a get together. And it's, you know, like, it's not like spirits and things like that, but you, I suppose you can still do as much damage on wine.
Okay. So run us through what are these big goals that you've got on your vision board?
Okay, so I wanted to put some goals around activity. There was something my young son said to me last year, I think I told you about, and we were talking about, I'd done a statement of intention, and it was around adventurous spirit, powerful body, strong mind, and a kind heart. And my son, I had it up on the mirror in our ensuite, my son, and he goes, "You're not adventurous, Mum." I was heartbroken, absolutely heartbroken that he thought that, because I was like, "I'm the most adventurous person you know." But he hadn't seen that side. And yeah, I just thought, he has to see that in me. My daughters definitely know that side of me. And so planning now to do Kokoda. I've done Everest Base Camp and Annapurna circuit in Nepal, and would like to go back there at some point with husband number two and my son. And the you know, we've done Machu Picchu, and I wanted to do some more hikes in Europe, but at the moment planning on Kokoda next year. There's another girlfriend that's caught up with a few weeks ago, and she's very keen, so we're starting to look into booking that as well. And so I've set a goal, other goals, 1,000 kilometers of cycling, which for me in the past wouldn't have seemed like a huge amount for this time of, you know.
What's the time frame? Is that for the year?
For the year.
Okay.
I probably won't do as much in winter, but the cycling now is more, you know, on cycling on the bike paths and with my son and so forth. So I think that's fine. 2,000 kilometers of walking, which I'm, and that's a mix of walking and cross-country skiing. So in winter, when we've got hopefully some snow, we'll be doing some of that. 12 books, so not so much time in front of the TV or having the TV in the background, having a conscious effort to sit and actually read at night to calm down before going to sleep. And my son added something to the vision board as well, which was more adventure parks. So we're going to do a few more adventure parks this year. And the other one for me is another 8 kilos down. So it was Fit Fabulous 50. So I'm 50 in June. So I've got 8 kilos to go. And that'll get me back to where I was when I actually met my second husband and when I was fairly fit.
Fantastic. Yeah. That's huge.
It's a big year.
All right, and so how far down are you at the moment?
I'm 11 kilos down.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
And so I'm gonna put a bit of pressure.
I've got 6.5 to go.
I'm going to put a bit of pressure on you to get the last little bit done, because
the last five.
One of the things is that I know that one of the great things mm-hmm. is that you're very consistent in your path. Like if you looked at Joe's progress as a trend line, then you know it's consistent. Mm. So I think I'm going to give you a push to step it up. When we'll discuss when. So we can time it when, you know, life isn't crazy at the same time. And yeah, you're not. Yeah. Yeah. So, but, and I only say it.
It's a bit crazy.
So I only say it because you're so close now.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that if you hover, if you plateau for too long, you can kind of like lose the desire.
Yes.
And the belief as well. So sometimes just doing a bit of a short, sharp, boom, focus. Yeah. Narrow focus, especially for you, because it's hard to
I think we need that, because mm-hmm. I'm at the level now I was when I was first training with you
mm-hmm.
and then I thought I could do it by myself, and so I need to be very mindful that I'm at that same stage again, so I don't want to say it because then you're going to push me, but I probably do need that extra push to get now that extra and into the sevens.
Absolutely. Absolutely. 70s. Don't worry. It's coming. It's been thought about. It's been conjured. It's coming. That's an interesting point as well. So on my side, okay. So there's the, like, part of my role, right, is being a trainer, but is obviously to educate and that kind of thing. Like, sure.
Hmm.
But I think for me, the thing that I've found to work best is actually, because I know, as you said, right at the start, you're like, Matt, I know what I should be doing. So it's actually about creating the environment all around you that you can't actually tangibly touch necessarily,
mm-hmm.
but that you just kind of start going, oh yeah, I'll take that on. I'll do that. I'll do this. And it comes from within rather than from a push or a direction. So what I mean by that is, for example, one, like us doing this podcast right now, means that someone else will be able to listen to this, see themselves, a portion of themselves in your shoes, and go, oh, beautiful. If that works for Joe, I can make that happen. And then seeing all the other girls, you know, in person as well, but obviously their stories too of progress. It when you're surrounded by that and that environment, it really subconsciously, I think, it changes you, and you go, okay, this is the norm. I need to rise to it, as opposed to, well, I'm surrounded by my friends that drink wine all the time, so I'm doing just fine.
Well, I think too, there's, for me, mm-hmm. the social side of coming to a group. I really enjoy that. I mean, we don't always have a lot of time to talk because you tell us off we talk too much, but it is nice training with a group of other women, and for those listening that are thinking of that and finding it hard on their own, that really has helped as well for me. There's also, I'm quite a competitive person in my world at work, and how I was when I was in my 20s and I compete and teens, I was competing. And so there's also that competitiveness, even though it's not a malicious competitiveness, it's like, oh, she's got to that level, I need to get to that level. So I think that it's got to be done in a way where it doesn't, you know, become an obsession. But I think that helps when you are in a group. Other people push you along as well. But yeah, sometimes, Matt, you piss me off so much when you push me, but I know I need it.
It's okay. Love, hate. Love, hate.
Exactly.
just consistently flows back and forth. It's just like a clock, you know, just the pendulum. Okay, so... on some other notes, because so a theme that I have seen, and your years down the line, and at the same time at the same point in a way. All right, let me explain what I'm saying. For some women that become mums and are very career focused, and they've crushed it all their life, prior to kids. And now they obviously want to continue crushing it. That seems like a logical thing to do. Mm. They don't want to give that part of themselves up. And so then they do work really hard. They make sure that everything's happening at home. And obviously, if you actually added up all the worked hours, paid worked hours, as well as non-paid worked hours, it's pretty enormous, right? So my question is, What advice would you give to the woman, for example, that is becoming sick pretty consistently, or is kind of putting on the kilos, and thinks everything's fine, but yeah, her body's kind of saying something else because she's being pulled in all of these different directions?
I would say, I know that work is important to you and your family is important to you, but if you're sick, or if you're not there from, you know, heart attack or stroke or whatever it is, then that would hurt your family more than anything in the world. You can be replaced at work, unfortunately.
Snap.
And they will. They do replace people. You know, and I feel like a bit of a hypocrite saying that because I do put so much effort into work and I do treat it, even though I work for a large corporate business, I try to treat it like my own and I work very hard for them. But at the end of the day, you've got to find time. And I know that it's hard when there's deadlines at work, but somewhere there has to be some time. And my ex actually was really good at carving out time when he was doing Ironman triathlon. And he would, as soon as he got home from his work, he would put aside time. And I know that's really hard as a mum. And for most people, that's really hard. But if focusing, you know, putting it in the diary, you know, there's a, everyone's using, you know, invite yourself, use a calendar invite in Microsoft, for, you know, that you actually put a calendar invite in and that's your time. And whether that is for a walk or PT or a massage or whatever it is, put that in for you. And it's a non-negotiable meeting that you have with yourself.
Mm-hmm. That's really good. And what about when it comes to, if you're open with talking about this, what about when it comes to, obviously working as a team with your husband, and because from the outside, I believe he's doing a great job. But how do you guys communicate in a way that you know, obviously doesn't make the other person kind of lash back or anything like that, or feel like they're vindicated? How do you manage those different, you know, responsibilities of the whole family?
Yeah, my husband's really quite easygoing, but he owns his own business and works ridiculous hours as well. I don't know.
Guys have a chat about it, like once a week, or do you look at what your rosters are? Like, some of it will be like just automatic and you won't even think about it.
Yeah, I was thinking we're in a pattern of things and what we do. So he takes our son to jiu-jitsu, and while he's doing that, he's training. And I'm really proud that he's starting to do more training. I think he's been inspired by me as well. He was high blood pressure, and with the tablets, it wasn't getting under control. He is still on tablets, but he's now back to really good, and he's lost weight too, which is great, and he feels better. We try to just work things around. I feel at the moment, and it's probably just the age that our son is, he's usually doing something with him and then I'm doing something else. It is hard to find time, the three of us. So we do try to do a bike ride together, or we do go to the movies together, and on a Sunday we try to keep Sunday as our day. But yeah, I don't know how to answer you. We just say, I need you to do this and you do this, and that happens. We don't think much about
it. Good to know. Well, yeah.
But he knows my mornings. He knows that I get up. I wake him up in the morning once I've done, you know, been to training, take the dog for a walk, unpack the dishwasher, made the kids' lunches. And as I'm leaving for work, I'm waking him up, because then he takes ownership and takes our son to school and so forth.
Yeah. Absolutely. All right. So, When you were getting started as well, something that I think will be important to touch on is, we're, especially because we work together, and then you were like, okay, cool, I've got this, I'm gonna go do it for myself, and then it didn't quite pan out the way that you wanted. I honestly didn't think about this whatsoever. It didn't even really come into my mind. Mm. But from your point of view, how did you feel about reaching out to me then?
Oh, it was one of the hardest things in some ways, but because I'd got to that breaking point, I knew I had to do something. I had to change my situation. But yeah, I felt like a failure, and I trained with you before and I couldn't believe I had then put on another 10 kilos after I had left training with you, because I thought I could do it on my own at that time, which obviously I couldn't. But yeah, shame, and I actually could not believe how heavy I was, that I'd got to that. And, you know, I didn't see... I knew, like I said earlier, I knew what food I should be eating and, you know, what I should be doing. But even then I thought, how can I be putting on so much weight? And, you know, people say, oh, it's your age, you know, it gets harder when you get older. And so in my head I thought, I'm never going to be able to lose this weight, which is ridiculous, because you do. As soon as you start, you know, just being more active and being more conscious about what you're putting in your mouth, it does start to drop. And I was really excited about how quickly, even with even small changes, how quickly I was able to see the changes on the scales. And even now, because I was sending you a text weekly on my weight, and if you scroll back, you can see it coming down, and that's a great feeling. And also there is, yeah, certainly a sense of achievement of being able to do that. But at the start, yeah, there was a lot of shame and feeling like I'd failed. And I'm not a person that usually fails in my life. Yeah. So yeah, that was, how am I failing at this?
Yeah. So it's like, I am a winner. Why? and yeah, I think something, yeah, so just like I was saying about, how I think about it is setting up an environment where you know, you basically, you will succeed. Mm-hmm. I also think that generally, the environment that, you know, yeah, basically every corporate woman is an environment, especially when they become mums, that is promoting unhealthy habits, because it's going to stretch you in so many different directions that effectively you're gonna highly likely want to self-medicate in some way. Food, alcohol, whatever. It would be very common for that to happen. Or you just keep on going until you're totally physically exhausted.
Mm.
And that does happen too.
So for this year too, and you asked about the vision board before, even though I'd started back about mid-year last year, by the end of last year, I was absolutely exhausted from work and trying to still juggle things.
Mm.
So I think that's part of the goal this year is, you know, I was able to achieve a lot and getting up earlier and doing that, but I do need to find some middle ground where I'm not pushing so hard. And I think that's always going to be a bit of a struggle, but mm. I need to make sure that I'm putting me first and not giving everything to work. Yeah, giving more back to the family.
Beautiful. Okay, so Joe's three, what would you call it? Your three tips for someone getting started, what would they be?
First tip is, it doesn't matter what your weight you are, what age you're at, or what you've done in your past. Just saying yes to yourself and starting, even if it's just walking, doing, you know, 30 minutes or even 15 minutes of walking a night, just start. And, you know, that's will start you on the path. Tip number two, yeah, finding, actually planning that time and saying, okay, this is me time. And the other thing is, set some goals, even if they're really small goals at the start, and then reward yourself when you hit those goals, but not with food.
That is
a new outfit or something like that. Yeah,
absolutely. Well, what has been the thing that's excited you most as you've lost as you come down the scales? Plus,
fitting into all my clothes that I'd put in drawers under the bed.
let's open up the chest. Yeah.
I used to complain to my husband, oh, nothing fits, and then if I was going somewhere special, I didn't want to keep going out and spending money on clothes. So yeah, that's been exciting, being able to just fit into clothes and they fit nicely without feeling like that everything was too tight.
Beautiful. And number three.
Make sure your family understands why you're setting these goals. In most cases, I think family will be very supportive of mums doing this, and I have found that with especially my older girls, that really being really supportive, and my husband as well. But I think making sure they're aware of what you're trying to achieve as well. Yeah.
Awesome.
No.
Beautiful. Thanks for coming down, Joe.
Thanks, Matt.
That's my pleasure. Cheers. Bye.